Power-ups have always been a part of platforming games. There is the mushroom, the star, and the fire flower in the first Mario game. There is the shield, the power sneakers, and the invincibility in the first Sonic game. There are the famous, inhalable enemies in the Kirby series. There are the crazy gameplay twists in the Galaxy games. There are the transformations in Yoshi's Woolly World, and many, many more. Power-ups have always been used in platformers to vary the gameplay and empower the player. Interestingly, the way platforming games use power-ups changed drastically over the years. In the beginning, they often just granted a short period of invincibility or a small gameplay upgrade, but nowadays they often completely turn the gameplay on its head. The interesting thing is that, in my opinion, the very first Super Mario Bros. Game found the perfect way to grant the player special abilities, and recent games are more and more losing focus on what makes a power-up feel really great and well integrated into a game. So are you ready? Here's why. So I want to talk about three main things in this video. First, why the power-ups in Super Mario Bros. Are so elegantly designed. Second, how the Mario series distanced itself from its own formula with the Galaxy games. And third, how modern games often integrate power-ups in a much more clumsy way than the first Super Mario game did. Before we start, let's just quickly define what I mean with power-ups in this video so that we're all talking about the same thing. I mean gameplay changing or enhancing abilities that are given to a player to vary the gameplay or to empower him. But what is important is that they are in some way optional and not tied to progressing through the game. In short, I mean the magnet shield in Sonic Adventures 2, but not the coin dash move, which you learn at some point and keep from then on. I do mean the abilities Kirby gains by inhaling his foes, but I don't mean the moves Banjo and Kazooie learn from bottles. So with the boring stuff out of the way, let's start with the classic Mario games. In the original Super Mario Bros., the controls are very simple. You have the D-pad for directional movement, the B button to run, and the A button to jump. That are the basic controls, and at its core, these are still the main controls in all 2D Mario games, up until today. Those are really simple mechanics, and part of the magic of the Mario games comes from really easy to understand and to use controls, but challenging and interesting stages. Now, how does obtaining a fire flower change these controls? Interestingly, the answer is it doesn't, it just enhances them. The D-pad is used for the same movement, the A button gives Mario the same jump as before, and the B button the same sprint mechanic. But additionally, hitting B now allows him to throw a projectile. Let's take a look on a couple of other Mario power-ups. The Super Leaf gives Mario the same jump on A, but in the air he has the ability to float a little bit by hitting A again. When at full P speed, the leaf allows to fly and the B button is still running, but when pressed, Mario performs a useful tail attack as well. The core controls aren't changed, and the interesting thing about this is, it is true for every single power-up in the 2D Mario games, old and new. Some give Mario better movement options. The Acorn Suit, for example, allows Mario to float in the air. The Propeller Suit grants a way better spin move, the Hammer Suit throws hammers, the Penguin Suit allows Mario to throw ice balls and to glide a little bit on slopes, and so on. But not a single power-up in the traditional Mario games changes the basic controls drastically, but they enhance them, in a way. That's even true for Super Mario 64. The basic controls stay the same when wearing a flight cap, but if Mario performs a triple jump, he's able to fly. The invisibility cap doesn't change his controls in any way, and the metal cap makes him heavier, but allows him to use his basic controls underwater. Designing power-ups this way is really clever, because they enhance and empower Mario, but they don't change the actual gameplay, and they're easy to understand as they're tied to the basic controls every player already knows. This makes them a really valuable addition for a player, because he or she still runs through the same stage, which is beatable with power-up and without power-up. The gameplay is almost the same, but with a power-up it's easier to beat a stage. But what makes this really cool is that these power-ups are so valuable that no player wants to lose them. In Mario, you lose them by taking damage, and that makes taking damage really punishing. No one wants to damage boost through an annoying obstacle, because these power-ups are not only power-ups, but Mario's health as well. It's a simple and really elegant system that gives a player something valuable which he wants to keep, enhances and varies his gameplay, and functions as his health. Super easy to understand and close to the core gameplay. It's an incredibly elegant solution for a lot of problems. Tons of games had systems like these in place. Kirby, for example, has a specific button mapped to the powers he learns from his enemies. If he has no powers, it's inhale, and if he has a power, it's use this power. Sega gave our hedgehog Sonic a shield or invincibility without changing any controls. And if we want to stretch this concept a little bit, we could also take the powers Mega Man learns from defeating his foes as an example. They give him more options on how to fight, but his movement and jump stays the same. But with Super Mario Galaxy, the way power-ups work in the Mario series changed. In the Galaxy games, there are still power-ups that function in a similar way as the power-ups did before, like the Cloud Suit that allows Mario to generate clouds below him instead of dropping down, but maintains the core gameplay otherwise, or the Rock Suit that changes Mario's spin attack into a crazy boulder transformation, but keeps his mechanics otherwise. But there were also things like the Spring Suit, which completely changed how Mario controls. Your movement now works different. The B button does nothing and the jump button gives you a completely different jump than before. Your in-air controls are changed and so on. The Boo Cape changes your controls drastically and the B suit overrides a lot of your basic movement options as well. The power-ups can't be kept for as long as a player doesn't get hit, but disappear once you leave the area that was designed for that power-up, and additionally the old tie between power-up and health is broken, which leads to a couple of new problems. The Fire Flower has to be on a timer, which is a little bit lame, and there's suddenly a problem with damage boosting. Take a look at this scene. Coins function as health in the Galaxy games, and here is an obstacle, and behind it are coins. There's literally no penalty for just ignoring the challenge, taking damage and grabbing the health directly behind it. Additionally, the challenges which evolve around power-ups are designed so that they can only be done with the power-up, and so the power-up has to be regainable at every point. That's by no means game-breaking, but this system lost its elegance, instead of power-ups being naturally woven into the game as gameplay enhancer, health and value to the player, they're suddenly minigames that change the gameplay. I believe the main reason why Nintendo left their old system is that the Galaxy games have a different focus than the 3D Mario games had before. Power-ups played no major role in the first two 3D Mario games. In Mario 64 and Sunshine, the stages were playgrounds, built for Mario to have an area where his brilliant movement can shine and the player is challenged to master exactly this movement. But in the Galaxy games, the focus shifted away from Mario, towards the stages. Suddenly every stage was built around a new, unique creative gimmick, and Mario became the tool to explore all these different worlds, instead of the worlds being tools for Mario to jump and toy around. The game is no longer about Mario, but about the galaxies. That's maybe one of the reasons why Mario lost a lot of his unique movement options when switching to the Wii, because the focus shifted away from Mario himself. And it might be the reason why power-ups are used in an unusual way for the Mario series in these games. I'm not trying to say the Galaxy games are better or worse than other Mario games. In fact, critics loved the games, users loved the games, the sales were great and I personally loved the games. So they probably did something right there. But what I want to say is that there was a shift in the Mario series with the Galaxy games. And there was a shift in game design in general at this time. Whether the tremendous success of the Galaxy games made other studios copy ideas from these games, or there was a general shift in the idea how to design a game at this time is debatable. But a lot of platforming games started to value variation in the different challenges higher. In fact, in some cases, they started to value variation higher than their core mechanics. Yoshi suddenly started to fly around as a missile shooting plane or a mole digging through the ground with completely different controls. Sonic suddenly discovered the power of the color wisps, which transformed him into a bird or into a drilling machine, which changed his core gameplay completely, and Kirby suddenly stopped to inhale enemies, but transformed into a tank. Whether this happened because of Galaxy can be discussed, but what definitely happened with some power-ups is that they changed from core gameplay enhancing options towards gimmicky minigames, and I think this is a trap in which some recent games walked into. There is this idea that the more varied a game is, the more fun it is, and this is definitely true to some degree, but at least I believe that it's never a good idea to distance yourself from the core gameplay beyond recognition in order to create more variation. Variation has to come in the level design, which surprises with amazing ideas, but not by changing the core gameplay from jumping around to being a motorbike or a weird black hole. This idea worked for the Galaxy games, and in all honesty, I'm not entirely sure how Nintendo was able to pull this off so that the whole game feels like a cohesive experience, but I think at least part of the answer is that the Galaxy games at their core don't focus on Mario, but on varying galaxies. The very first Super Mario Bros. Already had a brilliant system on which it's definitely possible to build upon. Cleverly used power-ups can enrich and vary a game by building upon the core mechanics. But if core mechanics don't work, transforming into a bird won't magically make the game any better. And if your core mechanics work fine, the question arises why to ditch them for an umbrella minigame, when this mechanic could be woven into the core gameplay in a more subtle way. There is a certain elegance in having simple gameplay that gets enhanced by small tweaks. Mario's power-ups are aggressive great example how to vary gameplay without losing its main focus. Interestingly, Mario went back to the old power-up design with 3D World and 3D Land, and it's going to be interesting to find out what Nintendo's plans for Super Mario Odyssey are. Thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed this little video. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to leave me a thumbs up, and maybe you feel like varying your subscription feed by empowering the subscription button by hitting it today as well. I hope you have a wonderful day, and to see you soon. Goodbye!